everyone. My name is Sarah. I just want to say first off that I'm sick today, so I apologize in advance. I'm kind of stuffy, and if I sniffle or cough or something, I apologize for that. So as Jen said, my title is Repoussé and Chasing in Small-Scale Sculpture, an Exploration of Interior and Exterior Space, and my mentor is Preston Saunders from the Art Department. So I am in the metals program at Bridgewater. I'm about 3/4 of the way through, and what we do in this program is we focus on design elements regarding jewelry and sculptural pieces. We mainly use nonferrous metals such as copper, brass, we use sterling silver, sometimes nickel or other things. And in this program, I've been building my basic technical abilities. Moving metal, it's called forging, using hammers, connecting two pieces of metal together or soldering, and many other techniques and skills. Some of the things that we've done in class, in addition to some jewelry, we've made some flatware, fork, spoon, and knife, bowls, boxes, some more three-dimensional forms, and I found myself interested in those forms and wanting to explore different ways that I can move the metal to create more texture and more organic forms, because a lot of the stuff that I've made initially has been more, despite being three-dimensional, it's kind of flat still, if that makes any sense, like the surfaces. So I discovered these two advanced metalsmithing techniques called chasing and repoussé, and they are not normally taught in class, and I figured that I could use those to help me explore what types of forms that I could create. These are some of the tools that I use using these techniques. It involves this, it looks kind of messy, but on the left-hand side there, that black thing, that's a bowl of what's called pitch, which is kind of like this like sticky tar-like substance that it's solid at room temperature, but when you apply a little heat to it, it becomes sticky and malleable, and you can put a piece of metal in there, and then you use steel punches and different types of hammers to hammer into the metal from the backside, so it creates relief on the front side. So that's essentially what the techniques are that I was studying. And I wanted a focal point for my research, so I decided to explore the visual and textural surfaces on these forms. So one of my, let's see, I don't know if I can go back. There we go. So I've been inspired by natural forms, and one form is this sea urchin here. The exterior is knobby and patterned, and there's these cool little holes in it. But the inside of this shell is very smooth. So I like that juxtaposition between the two, and I didn't want to directly replicate that, but I wanted to sort of come up with my own take on that and work with that. So another thing that interests me is crystals or crystal clusters, which you can see in the upper right-hand corner. There's a couple examples. So I wanted to find a way that I could incorporate some of these crystals as accents into my pieces. And then there's also, that's just a picture on the bottom of some of the different types of hammers that we use. And so this is my first sculpture. This is urchin number one. I hammered this from a flat 4-inch diameter circle of copper with a technique known as raising, which basically you start in the middle over a rounded piece of steel, and you just hammer around and around and around over and over again until you can raise it up into the form that you want. And then from there, I went in and used the chasing and repoussé to get these bumps coming out of it to represent the knobs on the sea urchin. And I wanted to explore an idea of tension between the interior and the exterior. So I came up with this idea of soldering these ball-headed pins into the center of each of those bumps, and then they would be reaching up to hold this crystal-like object in the middle. And the, it might be kind of hard to tell, but the inside of the bowl form is a high polish, and then the outside has this kind of dirty green patina to it. One of the things that I've been learning a lot about is different types of casting, which is something I didn't actually expect to learn much about this, so that was wonderful. In this instance, the crystal that I wanted to use was this brown colored crystal in the bottom left-hand corner of that picture. But because that crystal is the same color as the copper, it was going to be too bland. So I talked to my mentor about how I could overcome that, and he recommended making a mold of the crystal and then casting it. So I tried several different castings. I tried it in sterling silver, which it actually weighed almost 2 ounces, so it was a lot of sterling. But there wasn't any way that I could really clean it with while maintaining the sharp lines of the crystal, which is what I wanted. So I scrapped that, and I cast it in resin with a bronze powder. I was kind of hoping that would be metallic, but it just came out brown, so I was disappointed in that. And then I decided, or Preston recommended that I use enamel paint on just a wax version of the crystal. And so I tried that, and that's what I was going to use, but actually at the last minute some of the paint started scraping off, so I ended up just painting the actual crystal silver, and so that's what's in the center of it. So that's kind of silly, but it worked. Some of the setbacks that I had, particularly with this one, was that I didn't realize initially that in hammering the metal the way that I did, it became weak, particularly in the highest point of relief in those bumps. So then I went and I drilled holes and I soldered those pins in, and as I was moving the pins aside to polish the inside, they started to tear because they were just, you know, weak from being work hardened. So that was an issue for me, and I patched them up in several different ways, and it was mostly difficult because I would put the patina on the outside and then it would go through the holes and it would patina the inside. So then I'd go and I'd go to polish the inside, but then as I was holding it, then the patina would come off on the outside, so it was like back and forth. I felt like I was fighting with this sculpture, but it worked. It's in one piece now, so that's good. Moving on. Oh, these are some other images of this piece in just the production process. This was the color of the patina at one point in time. So this is my second sculpture, urchin number 2. My goal was to, I wanted to revisit that idea of the tension with the pins, but do it in a different way. And I wanted to use these single tapering crystals, but I needed at least 35 of them, and I don't know where I can find 35 crystals like that. So my mentor recommended that I try casting them. So another thing new that I learned was glass casting. So basically, here's some images of the process. In the upper left-hand corner, you can see the clay versions that I made. I attached them to little ketchup cups. And then they were cast in this plaster, so the top middle picture just shows what the mold looks like after the plaster was poured. Then I had to pick out the wet clay from each little hole, and then we put the powdered glass in. We put it in the kiln for about a day and a half, And then the picture on the top right is me breaking away the plaster, so you can see the glass there. And on the bottom, they all came out okay. They made it. It shows them trimmed on the bottom, and then this circle thing is, that was me planning how I was gonna put, where I was going to put each crystal. And I also got some holes in this second sculpture, so that was another setback. But I think this one wasn't as complicated, so it was a little more successful, I guess. Here's some examples of some of the patinas that I tried, but I didn't end up using. On the outside, for any of you familiar with my previous research with like pasta and patinas, I tried that. That's the top left, but I decided not to go with that. I made, for those of you who don't know, patina is coloring the metal using chemicals. I made a beautiful blue one on the inside that I had to, it wasn't gonna work with the crystals, so I had to get rid of that. And then there's some other samples of patinas, which actually all my sculptures and the patina samples are out in the hallway, so if anyone wants to check them out, definitely take a look. And then my third bowl, or my third sculpture, is mainly, it's a bowl shape out of copper. I wanted to do something more subtle, maybe not go with the intense crystal casting and that whole process this time, so I wanted to look at the cool squiggly holes in the sea urchin, and probably kind of looks weird in the picture, but I did a heat patina on this one when you just heat the metal with a torch and it kind of turns rainbow colors. So it's rainbowish on the inside and then it's sandblasted on the outside. I really enjoyed doing my research. I want to thank the ATP Undergraduate Research Office. I want to thank my mentor, Preston Saunders, and several other art professors who were very helpful to me. And I would love to continue the research. In the fall, I need to do a cohesive body of work, so I think I'm just gonna keep working on these sculptures, pushing my ideas, the natural forms, the different textures, and I also want to get more into warm glass techniques and the casting and fusing and that type of thing. So, thank you.